Good afternoon, everyone. Thanks so much for coming. I'm Olivia Wang, representative of the Ink Society. And just quickly to say, on behalf of the Ink Society, we are very honored and delighted to be the official education partner of the Ink Asia Art Fair, the third year. And just thank Ink Asia for their support and also for providing us this platform to promote modern and contemporary ink art. So we're extremely pleased and honored to have with us this afternoon Dr. Eugene Wang, who is a professor of Asian art at Harvard University. Thank you, Dr. Wang, for coming all this way. In this afternoon's session, quite an unusual and unique topic, Dr. Wang will speak about the connections and synergies between Chinese ink painting and time-based media, in particular in regards to the ink paintings of Liu Guosong. So without further ado, I'll hand it over to Dr. Wang. Thank you.
Thank you, Olivia, for the nice introduction. I also want to thank Ink Society for the invitation to this wonderful event. And also, I'm very pleased to speak in front of the artist Liu Guosong and his family. And also, particularly, I'm also very excited to see some of my former students. One of them I taught 20 years ago at Chicago. Without further ado, let me start. And I usually don't like the title that sounds like hot air. What I do, in plain English, it really means that time-honored media and time-based media is basically ink painting and film. Well, the point I want to make, it sounds a bit grander, is that the paintings that we're I'm going to discuss are grand and deserve this kind of grand treatment. And also, I think there is a bit more than that, in the sense that there is something profoundly interesting about these two media, that is the ink painting on one hand and film on the other. So there's, on the one hand, we could say, well, you know, ink painting has its own form of property. It does what it does, and the film has its own way of working things out. They are quite different. That's true. But on the other hand, there's something profoundly interesting about the way they explore the sense of time. And I'll show you how. So in any case, to answer my own question, can ink painting and film talk to each other? The obvious answer is yes. That's an easy answer. But really, the harder question is how. So today's lecture, I'm going to demonstrate that. And in particular, I want to use the case of Liu Guosong's painting as example, also test case, in part because I'm heading a film project on Liu Guosong's painting. So in, and today's talk is also largely a mapping of that project, and just to show you the work in progress. Now, I want to start not with painting by Liu Guosong, but someone you probably are not fully aware of. This is someone whose painting probably, as an ink painter, probably impact the largest population in the world. And his name is Taurus Wong, and he lived up to 106 years, and just passed away last year. And you may know what he created. And in 1942, he was asked to serve as an in-between artist. Basically, what that means is that you would have action scenes, you have figures, but in between, you want to make connections, and then he was asked to do that. But then he did something quite amazing with the film medium, and that completely surprised the Disney boss. Basically, he created the lyrical scenes using the skill set that he acquired from long years of practicing calligraphy and painting, particularly ink medium. So he is a classical case of someone who bridged the ink painting and the film medium. And one might ask, what is it then that that he possessed that made that transition or the bridging so much easier? Well, to start off, one of these qualities of an ink painting is that it is fluid, it has a certain whimsical quality, it allows the brush and the forms to go in a way that is hard to imagine oil painting could do the same with that kind of fluidity and whimsicalness. So that part obviously makes it easy for him to do the kind of animation that evokes strong sense of mood and lyric quality. Not surprisingly, American critics actually observed, even for those who have little training in Chinese art, nonetheless, they made the observation that Harris Wong's painting remind them of the lush landscape of Song painting. Well, I mean, there's a little not precise about this statement, but on the other hand, the observation does hit some kind of right note. If we think about the ink painting of a particular period, especially starting around early 12th century, around early Southern Song, there is a sense of lyric quality invested in the ink medium, and that allows the painting to go in a way that has the sort of flow and also the melodious quality. So I think the American critic did make the right kind of observation. So with that quality, one can go a long way. Back then, in 12th century or so, you would have paintings like Liang Kai giving you that lyric composition. And even in the 21st century, we still have the contemporary artists doing this animation using the ink painting medium as the anchor. But in fact, he wasn't trained in painting, and he was quite explicit about this. In fact, he was sat down by journalists and trying to pin him down as to what is about his ink painting exercise or training that allowed him to do this kind of animation. And he said, I never trained ink painting, I just produced kind of painting that looked like ink painting. But that's another interesting issue we want to explore. Why is it that the look-alike quality may fool you into believing that it is ink painting in the film medium? But anyway, this is a little more complicated. But just to follow the earlier line of thinking, just to say that this whimsical quality, this ink medium, this freedom, this flow, this melody, somehow is fitting for the film medium to capitalize on. And I want to show you a clip by a Tokyo-based design lab called the Team Lab. And I think they really successfully integrate this ink painting medium to the most amazing degree. was brilliant. It really played to one aspect of ink painting to the fluid, that is the fluidity, and then put that kind of fluid form into spatial dimension. So that is remarkable. But nonetheless, one has to say that there's something that the film medium didn't quite catch, that is the really a kind of gradations of drying versus wet ink, which is ultimately what ink painting is about. How do you fully make use of two sets of ink qualities to play against each other, and in that interplay you create something more subtle and interesting. And that quality is fully brought out in this painting by Xiang Zhenguo of the late Ming, as you can see here, and this is in Shanghai Museum. And now the point I want to make is that just to use the melodious fluidity of ink wash is just one aspect, but in fact, if you want to the ink painting to fully work out its strength and power, you need to bring in different qualities. And here's a very good example. Now, once you also put in a little motif, such as the lonely widow in the foreground, you are able to actually tell all kinds of stories. And so in this case, actually, the story is easy to get. So you have to just ignore the couplet inspired by it. Sometimes it's a formulaic obligation. They don't necessarily go together. The deeper narrative here could very much have to do with this wet, cloudy hill. Now, why is the wet, cloudy hill matter? Well, the wet, cloudy hill easily calls to mind the illusion about the legendary true king who visited the southern land, and there he had encountered with a Gaotang woman, and the woman, a beautiful woman, coming out of nowhere, basically offered her body, saying that, you know, I can be your pillow, and then they had a rapturous night together, and then afterwards she said, I shall be the morning cloud and evening rain on this cloudy mountain. And so that becomes a set illusion. So each time you see this kind of cloudy, wet kind of passage, you will, at least for the educated people familiar with the poet, can see, you will get that point. And now, and contrasting with that wet, moist landscape, in the background you have this lonely willow tree in the foreground that is not wet, that is dry, arid, barren, which essentially sets off an interplay with two kind of states. One is that you have that some kind of wet dream, and then you have this barren situation. So with poise well exercised in this kind of scenario, all you need is a little cue, like a, you know, cloud, willow. You can easily produce automatically, always like coming out of automatic process, poems, lyric songs, which is essentially what the poets, traditional poets work with. You know, it's a set of tropes. And then you can, I mean, in my class, I just ask my students, just say, okay, I'll give you these, try to come up with a poem. And I give them a little cue, and in particular, whenever it comes to willow, and especially the fading spring and so forth, the traditional conceit tend to be that they recall the old capital city, Chang'an. A lot of young students will go to Chang'an to sit for the imperial exams, and it was long drudgery and a boring days, so they kind of go to the a place called Zhangtai. Zhangtai is a place lined with willows. And it's actually also the place of courtesans concentrate. So these students would typically hang out with the courtesans. And then when they're done with the exams, they would say goodbye in the street diet. It was again a bank aligned with willows. And then at that time they'll say, oh, I will miss you, and so on and so forth. So with that in mind, you can easily spin off because actually very few people went through that that real scenario. It's all poetic scenario that you allow you to exercise this kind of you know, encounter and memory and so forth. So this is how it kind of worked out. So essentially, the forms are too small, so don't worry, I just summarize for you. Essentially, it is divided into two parts. Part one is that this voice, this I person, I narrative, basically say, you know, we had a great time together, and then you saw me off at this willow lined bank, and we were holding hands, and then the sails was raised, and I went. And the second part is essentially set in a different time, which is now, saying, all right, what I've just described was happened some time ago, and now it's another round of spring and so forth. But spring is getting old and faded, and you have these captains, and you know, and my thoughts turn to the distant land. Then, of course, the memory conjures up the land of the, you know, cloudy mountains, which of course is a euphemism for the amorous encounter and all that, you know. So it's getting sentimental and that. So this is a pretty formulaic for a lot of poets. If you want to exercise sort of this kind of sentiment, all you need is a willow, cloudy hill, and you can spin off this kind of lyrical situation. It's just a game. Now, you could map that onto this painting. I mean, not necessarily that this is embedded, but at least for the educated lyric writers, they would easily think of these thoughts and spin out this kind of situation. Now, all this is to say that a lyric painting, ink painting, can work out its implicit or potential narrative just by this different formal qualities, the dry ink versus the wet ink, and then with a little motif like willows, hills, then you can work out all kinds of situations. That's how things work. So that's the potential power of this medium, but it also has its limitation because it can always, it's mostly for intimate use. You can't work out the big grand scenes, all right? And in this case, the painter's own life and situation testify to the limitation of one kind of ink painting and call for another kind of ink painting. So in between, it was the momentum's dividing line of 1644, when his hometown was sacked by the Manchus, and he had to, and he and his family had to flee, and all their collection. He came from a big collecting family, and all the artworks was dispersed, and you know, so it was very painful. Therefore, you could see all of a sudden he couldn't deal with that wet, frivolous, hilly mount anymore. And so all of a sudden you could see what used to be the sort of wet, cloudy landscape become of this hard, rocky, solid forms. All right. And the same 1628 painting also became a model, but then reworked by another painter named Gong Xian in 1671. And you could see that the two compositions look similar, but except that Gong Xian couldn't deal with that wet, fluid, lyrical, hilly cloudscape. And apparently something else was going on. So here I want to tell a little story. The 1671, there's this man who turned 80. He was a storyteller. He lived in Nanjing, and he was often invited to the nobility's home, aristocrat's home, to tell stories. And so thereby making himself a very popular guest among these households. And in 1671, all of a sudden he turned 80, and it was a big deal. Why was it a big deal? His name is called Liu Jingping, anyway, in fact. And he was actually quite bound up with the whole history of the early Qing, actually the Ming-Qing transition. And here's the story. So in 1644, we all know the Chongzhen Emperor committed suicide in Beijing, and they set up the Southern Ming dynasty in Nanjing, and then it was run by a viceroy, Ma Shiyin, who allegedly made a mess of things, and then causing a lot of discontent and misgivings. So there was a general named Zuo Liangyu in Wuhan, who apparently harbored different design, and in fact he just wanted to go to Nanjing to take down the Mao's regime. And the person sent by some of the Ming lawyers to persuade Zuo Liangyu was this storyteller, Liu Jingping. So he went all the way to Wuhan to persuade the general to come to Nanjing to clear the throne, the bad ministers, so that they could have a better government. So they did strike drove towards the east and went as far as Jiujiang, and then as things were happening, the Nanjing government got very panicky. So they sent Shi Kefa, who was guarding the in Yangzhou above Nanjing, and sent him to Jiujiang to fight the Zuo's army. But Zuo didn't last long, actually. He just died of poor health in Jiujiang. And as soon as he died, of course, this attempt to change the regime went aborted. And Shi Kefa went back to Yangzhou, but that was too late. The Manchu army already stormed down and basically sacked the city and massacre. The famous Yangzhou massacre took place. And then and Shi Kefa himself committed suicide, right, or was killed. And that happened in Yangzhou. All right, so many years later, when Liu Jingping turned 80, people started to reminisce about this earlier episode and start to have this thought. What if Zuo Zhongliang didn't die? Or Zuo Liangming, sorry. What if Zuo Liangming didn't die? What if he succeeded coming to Nanjing? What a difference would have been made? So there's a great deal of outpouring of historical sensibility or sentiment. And this is all triggered by this man named Liu Jingping, who turned 80. So there was a great deal of painting about willows, about pavilion, and about this landscape, and that evokes dynastic change, right? So, and many poets start to compose poems, lyric songs, on cue for Liu Jingping. As you can see here, the poetic line and the painting essentially were saying the same thing, right? Also, before we reach that point, you could see that for Gong Xian's painting, he shifted from the white gong to the somber, dark, heavy, dark gong. And apparently, there's something in the 1660s that forced him to do that. And in fact, a lot of things happened in the 1660s, and essentially, to make a long story short, Manchu government was really cracking down on the southern gentry, and they beat them up, they humiliated them, so it was a time that southern gentry had a hard time. So everyone started to reminisce about this. What if history had turned out differently? What if General Zuo had driven to Nanjing? We would have had a different situation now. But in any case, you could see the change. So what is relevant for this long story is that I want to call your attention to this rise of a special kind of painting. And also, before we get to Liu Guozhong's painting, this is all very relevant, so I'm having this long tutorial. In the 1660s, there rose this whole genre called a poetic history. By poetic history, it was meant that there are certain things poetry, art, can capture that cannot be captured by historical narrative, by historical writing. What you see here is this Gongxian painting produced in late 1660s that is typifying a poetic, the pictorial equivalent of a poetic, historical poetry, which also raises the whole question of why in China there have never been equivalent of the so-called history painting. We just have to readjust our notion, what is history painting? In the West, history painting are the classical figures raising arms, doing the classical posture. Whereas in China, you don't have that. So, but does that mean China doesn't have a lot of historical dramas? Of course, China always had historical dramas, except that the painters and poets use different means of capturing that historical pathos. And Gongxian's painting exemplify that kind of poetic history. And the idea was proposed by a man named Qian Qianyi, and it has a set of tropes. A lot of it is about lamentation, winds, and powerful natural elements, and all that. So all that, if you string them up, it's almost like a good cinematic sequence. And we'll get more to this kind of cinematic sequence. And also, a lot of it has a lot of sound effect. So what makes Ink Medium, at this point, very special is that it has a soundtrack. It's like a modern film. On the one hand, it has some kind of the visual aspect, but along with it, there's a sort of implied inner soundtrack. And here's the one that we met by, again, by Gongxian, that has this beautiful poem, basically saying that there's a moon shedding on the river, and there's the fishermen singing. And then there's this poor garden girl chokes amid her madrigal. This is extremely beautiful. Basically, the poor garden girl used to be singing in the court and so forth, and now broke down in tears while singing, all right? So all that sound effect is achieved through the ink, the material property of ink medium, where you can see the melodious ink flow is supposed to flow freely to signal sounds, but it was covered up by choppy strokes, dry choppy strokes, to effect this almost like this choking effect, I would say. And Gongxian invented this mode called a jimofa, accumulated ink. Basically, it plays on the sort of psychology of the viewer. When you see the ink flow, you're supposed to imagine that it can flow freely, but the painter actually frustrates your expectation by giving you all these dry strokes so that the supposedly melodious flow is now checked. In the same way that the poetry says the singing girl break down, chokes a metal battery. All right. It's all very musical, very powerful, very full of pathos. And therefore, the critics would use this kind of language to describe this kind of painting, as you can see here. Again, this is all this is the sort of exercise in this so-called accumulated dry ink in Gongxian's painting. And for contemporary scholars, when they attend to Liu, Mr. Liu Jingping's performance, they were also conjuring up this kind of dark vision. You have sound, you have hang of knife, even though it's basically songs, but you would have all these images conjuring up. interestingly, for modern viewers, scholars, looking at Gongxian's painting, they were conjuring up exactly the same vision, same scenes. By Arthur Wedding and by Lawrence Sigmund, they were all imagining this kind of landscape full of these sounds and fury. So that's what I call the cinematic impulse really comes before. This is feel like this whole thing is almost like you're watching a film. And with that, all the soundtrack full of sound and fury being played out in conjunction with this very powerful composition. You would also have paintings like this that goes very well with one of the most powerful dramatic verse in the history of Chinese dramatic literature from the Peach Blossom Fan, where basically the storyteller using his voice talking about the dynastic change. And as you can see here, it's basically a string of images, all like a montage, like film montage. And then constantly one shot changes to another. I look at, I see, I see, I see, I see. And then it ends with a lamentation, and a powerful lamentation of this dream of the fragmented landscape. Land we know, the map we draw. All right, keep this line in mind when you look at this painting. These are exactly the subtext for Liu Guosong's painting. We know from Leslie Ma that, in fact, Leslie Ma's dissertation makes a point that for Liu Guosong's generation, there is this lamentation of over the lost land, of the land we know, the map we draw, the sense of disorientation, the sense of loss, the sense of memory, strong pathos of memory. So essentially, I'm setting up to just to say that all that situation in the 17th century was replayed again in Liu Guosong's time by Liu Guosong's painting. And by the way, these two paintings are both at Harvard Art Museum, so we had the chance to closely study them. But you could see that these paintings scream cinema in the sense that they really have that powerful voice and soundtrack that I think is best articulated in this in these lines from the Peach Blossom Fan. So now we are, as I said, doing a film project on Liu Guosong's painting, and we basically map out the larger story. And here's our chart, and to give you a sense of how this narrative can develop. Today I don't have the time just to go through all the aspects of it or single out all the narratives, because it really has different narratives all built into one. But just to say that there's overall, we decided that the one larger narrative is someone who had gone through a lot and eventually managed to transcend all that and then get to a more sublimated level from the earlier memory of displacement, quarrels, and different kind of quests, eventually get to the moon, and finally get to the cosmic level, take painting to the cosmic level. Anyway, that's the larger thrust of it, but I just want to show you some of the research we've done and to show that, in fact, what sort of personal experiences that led to Liu Guosong's artistic achievement. As you can see, he lost his father when he was age 6, and then his family was constantly on the run, and he went with his mother and all of on the road, and then he entered this orphanage college, school, Yibu Xueqiao. Basically all the orphans were from the children of the generals, Kuomintang generals. And then eventually in 1949, they crossed the channel and went to Taiwan. And in the 50s and early 60s, they were still obsessed with the lost land, with their old life, memories, family, and so forth. And then eventually they managed to move on to transcend that and get to another level. So that's the sort of Panda's life, Panda's historical experience that certainly played a key role in forming this kind of painting. But if you press me and say, what it is about Liu Guohong's painting that is so special? And one might say that, okay, it's a fine way of solving a big problem in the history of Chinese painting. What is the big problem? If you look at painting, any painting, there are always two aspects. One is that the painting tries to create some kind of illusion, as if you are in a scene present, looking at what is out there. That's one aspect, what we call the optical. Another aspect about painting is that it's haptic in the sense that it is about the hand making marks and traces on the surface. Now, so if we really come down, it comes to two sets of problems. One is to feed the eye, another is to play out the hand. Unfortunately, they don't go well together. If you emphasize a lot more about the visual illusionism, you can't do too much about the hand leaving marks on the surface, because that would destroy the unity of the visual illusionism. If you do too much of this hand, the scratching the surface, you lose the illusionism. So this is a problem long standing in the history of Chinese painting. You would have 11th century painting really speaking to the eye, positing a sense of self looking at things out there. And when you get to the 14th century, you have a lot of painting essentially working out the surface, working with a hand. So essentially, left and right is eye versus a hand, all depending on which side you go. So even though by the 14th century, there's still some kind of space out there, but it's really not much. So to the extent that you basically lost that earlier illusion, and therefore make the things less powerful. This is a problem. I don't think Chinese painting fully recover from this problem. Different generations of painters try to work out, find a way of speaking with the eye and the hand at the same time, but it's always very hard. So as late as 1935, when people like He Jianjian went out there, because for a long time, since you would basically work with handworks from 14th century on, you don't need to look at nature, really. You don't go out there to paint from nature. So outdoor sketching was very, very rare, if at all. We don't know they did it in the 11th century, but we certainly know from the 14th century on, people don't need to go out there to look at nature. All you need is just master's model. You can just work out master's model with it. So in the 20th century, when painters started to go outdoors, adopting the Western practice, they need to face the outdoor landscape. But they also have to somehow, some of them, at least still want to retain this hand aspect of painting, the haptic aspect of painting, the texturing strokes, the texturing model. So what you have here is, in He Jianjian's painting, this very curious situation where you see this group of people looking out the mountain. And what they try to do is that, let's look which section of the mountain look like what texturing stroke. In other words, they were still trying to reconcile the eye and the hand, all right? So it's interesting to see Liu Guohong working with the same problem. And much has been said about Liu Guohong's use of Fang Tuan as a model that inspired his innovation. But if you just reduce it to the tradition versus modernity, you kind of miss the whole point. The whole point, I think, is how, for the painter, how do you retain a sense of monumentality, something out there, but in the same time giving free rein to your creative hand. How can you both speak to the eye and the hand at the same time? That's the problem I think he's working with. And by the time of this Harvard painting, 1970, I think he has fully worked that out. So he has the most powerful sense of the illusionism out there, but at the same time, the texture really plays out the hand, the handwork. In fact, in this painting, he did this sort of ripping the vein from the surface of the sheets of paper to just, you know, have more of a sense of the handwork out there, right? So, so we've done a lot of research on this aspect, and I said to tell a story of Beautiful's painting, you can zero in on all kinds of potential narratives. But we work on some of the overlooked aspect. Like for instance, we noted that when he started, he actually started in the painter shop, where mounting shop, where you have to work with the materiality of the painting a lot, mounting, ripping things apart, remounting together, and so forth. So we've done a great deal of research of the, what is the mounting shop's practice in the 1930s, and we found a lot of visual material. I'm going to quickly go through some of these historical photos showing how mounting and working with different aspects of painting was done. And to some extent, one might say that kind of muscle memory must have been retained by Liu Guosong, even though subconsciously he probably would deny it. I would say it doesn't matter for me, but you know, I think it might have planted certain seed that eventually, given certain trigger, would play some role in the way he worked with material medium of in painting, which involves, one might say, actually involves building some kind of structure on the sheet of paper, right? In other words, if we want to reconceptualize the sort of painting that Beautiful produced, in some way, it's a building structure involving different layers, and, as we can see. So, and part of it has to do with also a number of different kind of experience he had. We noted that he worked in architecture department. He also lived in Botanic Garden. And I think to some extent those experiences probably contributed to a special kind of painting that he produced. And so in order to that, we also did some research about what sort of vein pattern that come from plants may have or may have been inspired or can be correlated to certain kind of pictorial quality in his painting. And this is the Harvard painting, that the close-up view of some of these textures that you can see. And we also worked with different formal experiments, the effect of the marbling effect on water, which probably recall some of the early use of so-called water brush in creating some effect. And our team really gathered large samples of different modeling effects to simulate the kind of process that led to Liu Guosong's painting. But all this formal aspect, or just formal aspect, well, we didn't lose the sight of the fact that, in fact, it is also that big historical experience he went through that might have a telling effect on his work. So in the film, we try to bring these two together. On the one hand, that historical memory. On the other hand, this formal experimentation, the formal material process. And back to the chart, another key moment in his career is, of course, Fly to the Moon. That was marked a high point in his career. And we all know, for those of you at least who read about Yu Gozong, you know that moment when he used the lantern paper and mount that on a sheet of square paper and then create this moonscape. And but the story is larger than these words. In fact, they led to grander visions of, in other words, Yu Gozong is really the first one to bring the Chinese painting from landscape to the cosmic dimension with that kind of grandeur and getting grander. So in order to observe how this moon spectacle works, our team would gather all sorts of materials just to figure out how you film to capture that moonscape in different aspects. Also, we thought that Yu Gozong's encounter with the moonscape is interesting, that it is also a global event. And there is some kind of East-West really coming together through this shared interest in Apollo moon landing. And in particular, we compare Liu's work with the Rauschenberg, who took that moon landing as the occasion to imagine a different possibility of living, in fact, or a different bodily sensation. That sort of, according to him, once the rocket starts to soar into the sky, he feels like it takes the whole body and human existence into space. So, and then it's interesting, while Liu Gozong was looking at the moon, thinking his own thought, Rauschenberg actually was looking at the China moon, on the moon over China, over the Great Wall, and it was a very heady moment when all these interactions were taking place. And then, of course, in America, they have a different kind of problems. So it is a moment to compare notes, to see someone from Taiwan who had been to the US and who was inspired by Apollo moon landing, thinking, but his private thoughts that probably had to do a lot to do with his memories, memory space, and so forth. Whereas Rauschenberg was figuring out his kind of moonscape with the tumultuous years of the 1960s and 70s. So with that, our team had some proposed sequence. This is very sketchy yet. We haven't settled on the moon landing scene, but this is just one of the proposed sequence.
Thank you.
one final moment that brought this narrative to a climax is actually when Liu Guozong actually went to, in his later years, to Himalaya, where it was quite an extraordinary experience because he lost possibly his hearing. And I thought that was a very powerful cinematic moment because loss of hearing, loss of sight, somehow can produce amazing cinematic effect. And also this is quite a transcendent moment in the sense that he felt all that earlier worries and things that start to really fade away at that high altitude. And this is the sort of thing we were really holding our breath for when we get to the actual making of the film. But here's one, again, from our team, one of the proposed sequence, and it's just a thought experiment. I want to close with the trailer that captures all these previous analysis and narratives and just pack them into one 5-minute trailer.
Ah!
time to talk about the impact of 1980s liberals in Harlem, China, and I just want to quickly go through the images and want to end there. Thank you very much. Yes. Hey, how many? Maybe we should ask.
Yeah, sorry. My question is, since Marshall Lewis is here, should we give him a chance to rebuild himself?
Absolutely. I think Lee should come here to translate. Okay. I think you should here to come here to translate.
He's actually quite hands-free on this, so no, he didn't intervene, and I think that he was very generous to just let us do whatever we want, and so I think that it's probably better for everyone that. More questions? Okay, thank you very much for coming. Thank you.